Good evening, everyone. My name is Wan Ting. Thank you all for joining us after a long day of work. It's Friday tomorrow, so yay! So I am with the data science team at Allianz. It's a German insurance company, and I also lead the Singapore chapter for Girls in Tech. And that the both this will come up later, so I'm just gonna skip this for now and proceed on to my presentation. So when Victor told me about this presentation, I caught a very key word from him. He said it's gonna be a very pragmatic sharing session. So I took it very seriously. So at the end of this 10-15 minutes, I hope you bring away with you some practical tips that you can use to debug your learning algorithms, as well as a better understanding of what model bias is and the forms and shapes that it comes around, and then more practical tips on how we can stay conscious of all this. Okay, so the term bias is such a big term, so I thought I should break it down so that we can deal with it systematically. So in machine learning bias, Mitchell actually defined it in 1980 that it is any basis for choosing one hypothesis over another other than a strict consistency with the observed training instances. So what this is saying is really that every model is biased because we are not going to just train it based on the training sets, right? So the good and the bad news is that there is a reducible part of model bias that we can try and reduce, and there's an irreducible part, which is noise and hidden variables and things like that that we need to be conscious of. And to reduce the reducible parts, I'm going to just have a few rule of thumb that you can use and hopefully apply it when you build your own models. So there are two terms that comes into play here, statistical bias as well as statistical variance. I don't want to bore you with the long names. I will give you an example of how this is defined. So assume that you have collected five different training algorithms, five training sets, and you have an algorithm that you run for these five training sets. So how do you tell that a model is high bias? A high bias model means that it is consistently inaccurate. So it's far away from the accurate point in this dartboard. As opposed to a high variance model, it's inconsistent but averagely accurate. Got it? All right. So to solve this problem of model bias, the trick to this is to find a balance between bias and variance. And to do that, you have to decide which side of the curve you are on. So if you're on the left side, that means there's too much bias in your model. And if you're on the right side, that means there's too much variance. To decide which side you're on, you plot your learning curves. So when you plot your learning curves, the y-axis is the error that you're facing, and you increase the training sets that you're seeing that you have. If you see that the gap between the training error and the test error is consistently big, and it doesn't come down, and that your test error is really high, this means that you have a high variance set model. But on the other hand, if the gap is close, and but your training error is high, that means that you have a high bias model. All right. Okay, so for each of these situations, you can try different methods. For high variance, it means that your data set is not big enough, so maybe you should try putting in more data points. This will reduce the variance of your model. Or you can try a smaller set of features, because this means that the features that you're putting in is over-describing what your data set. And for high bias, it means that you're not putting in enough features to describe your data set properly. Okay, so I'm done with the technical part. I'm just gonna bring you more interesting things, so practical things that, right? Okay, I can see, okay, so one last slide, sorry. So inherently, all the algorithms have their own bias. So there is the less complex algorithms like linear regression, they come with high bias because, like for example, if you look at the linear line below, even if you add 10 more points to it, it's not gonna shift your line a lot. It's gonna look like that, right? So for less complex algorithms, it tend to come with high bias. But for more complex algorithm on the right, it tends to overfeed and bring in it more variants. Okay, now I promise I'm done. Okay, so what exactly is model bias? So as I mentioned earlier, I work with an insurance company. I'm not here to sell insurance, don't worry. Allianz does not have a license to sell in Singapore yet. So, but what I found is that there is some bias against insurance industry as a whole. I have no idea why, but I have two statements over here and see if you can spot the myth around it. The first one is insurance premium always looks expensive until you file a claim. And the second one is insurers do not want me to claim and make it impossible to. Anyone? Which is not true. I know they both look true, but that's what, that's not true. Right? And you'll be very surprised. Insurers do want you to claim. I was very impressed, and I'm not saying that Allianz is very good, but it is. But I was very impressed. I was very impressed when I sat into a management meeting at Allianz Malaysia, and they were discussing how they wish that, not that they wish that their customers will get into an accident, but they know that if a customer claims and experience the good claims experience that they face, they would become a promoter for Allianz. This is how it happens, right? They want them to claim. So, and I think it's working because in Malaysia, Allianz is one of the biggest insurance, motor insurance, has the biggest market share in Malaysia. All right, so with this group of motor customers that we have, how do we provide better coverage to them? Because unlike motor, life or personal accident products are not claimed that often. How do we let them know that Allianz, you should buy Allianz products for life and personal accident as well? So data scientist comes in. So we look at all the data we have, which are information on the car, and then their purchase history with us, as well as their capacity on whether they will, how much they can afford, because we want to target the right customer. This is all about being efficient and catering for the customer's needs. Yeah. And after we look at this, the model was fantastic. It's 78% accuracy. We are very happy. We were super excited. We brought it to the business owner. And then he said, so we were looking through all the results that came out. He told us, something looks wrong. Do you realize that these people that you are recommending that I sell to already have a personal accident product with us? So he said, why not? Because it's a yearly renewable product, so it makes sense that you should prioritize them and sell them again. Then he said that it's because they are already incentivized to renew. So this buying behavior was not thought of at first, right? It came out after. So it brought to us this flag that says that we did not think about what the customer was experiencing when she bought the product. Was it because she genuinely needed it? Or is it because it's a renewal? Or is it because there was a promotion? Or is it because someone actually had an accident and she... So a bit of psychology here. The best time to sell a fire insurance to a shop, maybe, is when the neighbor's shop just got burnt, right? Make sense? Okay. So, you know, this came as an afterthought at that time. And fortunately, for most of this, we have a solution to it. It's just paying more attention to the data and make sure that we put in the right data into it. So for renewals, we drop all the renewals and we focused only on first-time buys. For promotions, we look at time trends. And for connections, this is a bit hard because this information is never captured. But what we do is the best of what we can. We look for a lot of large numbers. We look for agents who are very experienced and consistently selling this product to make sure that their customers, most of their customers anyway, would be the ones who are needing it. All right, and the thing about this is, if we had done our exploratory data analysis before that, is there any way we could have foreseen this coming in? Could we have foreseen this behavioral bias coming in? And the thing that I think we probably would not are those first-time buys and also experienced agents and the connections. So the lesson that I took away from this is really to work very closely with the business, and I cannot emphasize it enough. to work very closely with the business and ask the right questions. Ask a lot of questions and think about all these biases. So aside from behavioral biases, what other biases are there that's possible? And there's this research that was recently published on Science Magazine on how artificial intelligence can acquire racial and gender biases as well. So they said that the words female and woman were most closely associated with arts and humanities occupations and with home, whereas male and man were closer to math and engineering professions. You know what this means? It means if a HR person who's looking for the next top data scientist to hire use this algorithm, my name will not have appeared in the search, right? And it's their loss, I think, right? So on top of gender biases, there is also racial bias in there. So African-American names were associated with pleasant words such as gift and happy, while African-American names were more closely associated with unpleasant words. I'm sorry. I'm not right. Yeah. So it's very troubling. I think it's a very real problem. What can we do to be more conscious about this? So Google, for one, has already announced two new open source tools that can help you do your EDA properly, which is like to slice your data and test your model such that it will be able to tell you how you can look at segments that you have not considered. But for practitioners in the house, what are the things that we can be conscious of to fight this model bias? So I would say the cliche, be conscious to unconscious bias. I know it's difficult, I'm very guilty of it, but you know, three very practical stuff that we can do. Take note of selection bias in training data sets. I think Simon mentioned earlier about the racial bias that they saw, and Google also tagged black people as gorillas, and hidden variables. Just because you took out race and gender from your variables from your training set does not mean that these variables is not hidden in your data set. For example, in US, if you live in a certain district, right, there is a high probability you belong to a certain race. So be conscious of all this. And the last one is what we spoke about earlier, existing social bias. So, I think what I want to say in summary is really to think about this unconscious biasness and ask a lot of questions. How we can get rid of this is really through asking a lot of questions, and how do you make sure that you ask the right questions, and that is to make sure that you have a team of diverse people that comes together and work together in asking all these different questions. And with this, I'm going to do a bit of sales pitch. I'm from Girls in Tech. I lead the Singapore chapter. We are actually a global non-profit organization. We have over 60 chapters around the world. So we aim to create this community and platform to engage, empower, and educate girls and women who are passionate about the industry to have a voice in this industry. What we do is that we focus on building pipelines and engaging girls, and also empowering ladies on confidence and leadership skills. And the last one are technical boot camps that we hold to educate them on the skills that are very necessary for them. So, open call for volunteers. If any of you feel for the cause and have some time to spare, please feel free to approach me. And also, you don't have to be a female to support this cause, right? Victor, it's a very strong support. It's all thanks to Victor that I'm here, and he is really very supportive. All right, so that's all I have for today. Thank you all very much.